We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
Welcome. It's Monday, everybody, and I want to welcome you to the Born to Talk radio show. I love doing this every week. Conversations plus connections equals community. And that book that's out there germinating in my mind, What's Your Story? That's coming maybe this year. Who knows? You're listening to Ripple by the Grateful Dead because my guest today is Alan Franz. Alan, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Marcia. It's great to be with you.
Oh, I'm delighted to have you here. And this is one of your song selections because you're a deadhead, and that's fine with me because we listen to the same music. But why you are here today is because you are representing the Palos Verdes Peninsula Land Conservancy, and that's what this show is going to be all about. Last week when Gina was here, we were talking about landscaping and water and all of those kinds of important resources. Today we're going to be talking about a type of resources, which are conservancies. But before we do that, I think it's always nice to let all of you know something about the guests that sit in the studio with me each week. So we're going to do that with you. It's kind of like that Spanky and Our Gang, that song. I'd like to get to know you. Yes, I would. So let's hear a little bit about your background. Where did you grow up, go to school, all that good stuff?
Well, I was born in scenic Long Beach.
Scenic Long Beach.
Long ago.
Mm-hmm.
But my father was in the Navy. And as a child, we moved around primarily between Virginia, California, and Hawaii.
Uh-huh.
And I ended up going, for example, to four different high schools. But
wow.
I ended up my last 2 years of high school at Palos Verdes Peninsula High School.
Wonderful.
Palos Verdes High School.
Okay.
Here in Southern California.
All right.
And I've lived in San Pedro since 1975.
All right. So a long time. And for people that don't know, you live in a little slice of heaven, don't you?
Well, San Pedro's got the good, the bad, and the ugly. It's a diverse community.
Uh-huh.
full of opinionated people.
Right.
It's a whale of a town.
It is. No pun intended, because you can go whale watching, maybe not right in Palos in San Pedro, but you don't have to go very far to watch the whales.
Well, there are whale watching promontories on the coast, and you can catch boats from San Pedro.
Oh, can you with San Pedro as
yeah.
well? You know what my favorite thing that's by the water of all times is I'm into the pelicans. The brown pelican is probably, if you said you could only photograph one bird, now I know hummingbirds are pretty big to me too, but a pelican is the weirdest looking bird ever. That beak, that body, when they fly, they look like dinosaurs. I mean, I love the pelican. Okay, but that was about me. So you live kind of all over the place. You graduated from PV High, and then what? Where did you go off to college? What was your college experience like?
I went to UC San Diego for a couple of years, then transferred up to UC Santa Barbara.
Okay.
I started out as a biology major, but eventually ended up with an individual major in social and behavioral sciences.
They allow you to do that more at Santa Barbara. Was it more creative opportunity? Is that why you moved there?
Mix of things.
All right.
The program I was in at UC San Diego, I was not a big fan of the emphasis on physics and chemistry,
okay.
which was pretty intensive.
Uh-huh.
So I muddled through that and then changed majors.
Got it. Well, you're really by the beach again, and you're in Santa Barbara. What a beautiful campus that is.
Yes.
Really. And then what did you do? What came next for you?
Well, I worked for a while in the Santa Barbara area, and then got a job with Grumman Aerospace.
Okay.
Making airplanes, and ended up in Northern Virginia.
But you didn't have an engineering degree.
No.
Okay.
I was a machinist.
All right.
And I worked at Sterling in Northern Virginia at a Grumman plant.
Okay.
And then I applied to graduate school and attended in the anthropology program at the American University in Washington, D.C., home of NPR.
Oh, that's neat. Was that a two-year program?
It was multi-years, altogether, including field work in Mexico. And writing my dissertation, it took me almost a decade to finish things up. But 3 years of steady full-time classwork.
With the PhD?
Yes.
Doctor. I suddenly found myself going into a movie. Doctor. Anyway, all right, so anthropology. So you're an environmental anthropology professor. And is that correct? Or is that what you were? And
well, it's what I am.
It's what you are. Let's just say that. Okay, let's get it straight. But all right, now that I can't even say it straight, can you define that for me? What is it? What's the difference? What's an anthropology professor?
Well, environmental anthropology didn't actually exist as a separate specialty within anthropology when I was in school.
All right.
But anthropology is the study of humankind, and it includes cultural anthropology, which studies the diversity of human cultures today, archaeology, which looks at the past record of human activity, physical or biological anthropology, which studies human biological diversity, human evolution, comparisons between humans and primates, apes and monkeys and other creatures like that, and linguistics, our capacity for language and the diversity of languages that we have. So on a program, Talk Live, Born to Talk, we are a species that has a brain pre-wired to acquire language. We don't have a specific language built into us, but we have this extraordinary capacity to acquire language, and we use it all the time.
You know, I'm going to do this all the time, just so you know. I was on Facebook, oh, really, big surprise, and I was watching something, I think from the Audubon, I think that's where it was from, and this woman, oh, no, I don't remember where it's from, but it was about Alex the parrot, and how this woman, the parrot was 30 years old, and how she got this parrot to truly speak English and understand shapes and sounds and sizes. And anyway, I mean, when you talk about linguistics, you don't really think about, well, now let's talk, you know, let's Dr. Doolittle, let's talk to the animals. But evidently, that's entirely possible as well.
Well, many people, too, have heard of, for example, Penny Patterson and her work with Coco the gorilla.
Right.
Learning sign language. So there are a number of communication systems that researchers have tested with different species, and they're smarter than we used to think.
I subscribe to a lot of different webcams and things, and you and I had talked about how smart crows are, and we're going to talk about that a little bit later. Birds can be really, really smart.
They're very clever. They can learn to solve puzzles of all different kinds.
Yeah.
And again, we're just the tip of the iceberg in terms of understanding what they're capable of mentally.
So where were you a professor? Where did you teach?
Well, I began teaching actually while I was living in Mexico, but I taught my first job here in California was up in Monterey County teaching at Soledad Prison. I taught in California Youth Authority for a number of years.
Really?
I taught at Ventura and Moorpark Colleges, and I've taught for, well, I taught for the last 30 years plus at Marymount College, which is now Marymount California University, for the last 4 or 5 years.
And that is a separate university from Loyola Marymount, is that correct?
Yes, up until, 40 or some odd years ago, Loyola was a men's college and Marymount was a women's college. They merged. Most of the students and faculty went to the Westchester campus, but they left about 200 students and a small core of faculty on Palos Verdes Peninsula and expected it to wither and it didn't. It's still there.
Wonderful.
The university now has, in addition to the main campus, on a beautiful spot on a bluff overlooking the Pacific and Catalina, there are two small campuses in San Pedro and another up in Lake County, where I spent a good part of the last 3 years.
In Lake County?
Lake County,
Where's
which is
that?
About 100 miles due north of San Francisco. So it's a beautiful rural area. The whole county has only about 65,000 people.
Oh,
it
no
has
kidding.
Two state parks. About a third of the county is in Mendocino National Forest.
I was going to ask you, so is that Mendocino, is that the closest city I would be familiar with?
It borders Mendocino, Napa, and Sonoma
on
the south and west.
That's really beautiful up there too. There's a point. There's something up there.
They have lots of fires that have put them in the news.
Yeah, but I remember, this was so many years ago, taking a drive up there and was like, you don't want to miss this in the Mendocino County where you looked over the ocean or something, but now I don't remember what the name of that was.
Well, Mendocino's beautiful.
Yeah,
but
it's
got a lot of points.
Yeah, evidently so. Well, it's interesting that there's so much around, and it sounds to me like you are a man that's never going to be too far from the water.
Well, I've traveled across the country a number of times. My last vehicle died with 488,000 miles on it.
Oh,
and
it
had gone
a
from
newbie.
Belize to Alaska.
Really?
And coast to coast a number of times. So I like to travel.
Uh-huh. That's nice. We're going to talk about that as well. But it's okay. So Marymount, so you taught, is that a, now that, when you taught there, that was a co-ed's campus, correct?
Yes.
All right. And do people get a four-year degree there or a two-year degree?
Well, originally when it was Marymount College, it started as a two-year degree, but it has expanded. Now it has a four-year degree and several master's degree programs.
Oh, nice. Nice. And how, do you have any idea how many students attend?
About 1,000, give or take.
Oh, okay. So a nice small campus with a beautiful view.
Yes.
Wow. Well, we're going to take our very first break. It's given our viewers have had a chance to know a little bit about you, Alan. And I chose this song because I thought it was good for us because we're going to be forever young. And this is Bob Dylan that's going to take us for a break because you know what? What's the option? Why not stay forever young, right?
Absolutely.
I like that. I agree. So stay tuned, everybody. We'll be back right after this short break.
See the lights around you. May you always be courageous, stand upright and be strong. And may you stay forever young.
Hi, I'm Delady Jones, and I'm a certified relationship and divorce coach.
And I'm Debbie Carlin Boyle, a certified personal trainer, fitness instructor, and health coach.
Join us on Tuesdays, 2 p.m. Pacific, for Del and Debbie's Mind, Body, Soul, and Everything in Between, exclusively on LA Talk Live.
Become part of the conversation with expert guests discussing life-changing topics such as relationships, divorce, longevity, parenting challenges, dating, intimacy, and so much more.
We would love to hear your opinions and questions either on our Facebook page or by calling us directly at 323-473-3100. We are Del and Debbie's Mind, Body, Soul, and Everything in Between. Tuesdays, 2 p.m. Pacific on LATalkLive.com.
You can also catch us on iTunes Radio R&B and now live on Facebook, or watch and listen directly at LATalkLive.com. And now on our YouTube channel, Del and Debbie Mind, Body, Soul. Reality radio handcrafted for your listening and viewing pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
Oh, mercy, mercy me, right? Don't, we grew up with fabulous music, didn't we?
Absolutely.
Oh, my gosh. I know the kids today think that they have fabulous music in Rihanna and all these groups, but, oh, man, this speaks to our soul, doesn't it? Well, anyway, I'm glad we're back together, and we're going to be talking. I mean, the focus of the show today is really about the Palos Verdes Peninsula Land Conservancy, and because I don't know a lot about what conservancies do, let's focus on that. Maybe what you can inform me and educate me about, and our viewers and listeners, is what are land conservancies?
Well, land conservancies are kind of a new movement. The trusts have been around for a long time, and land trusts and land conservancies have really taken off over about the last 30 years.
Okay.
Our conservancy, the Palos Verdes Peninsula Land Conservancy, or PVPLC, was formed basically in 1998. So we're actually one of the first 100 or so in the country. There are now about 1,700.
Really?
So they've really expanded. There are now about 56 million acres in land conservancies just in this country. California is one of the hotbeds of land conservancies. So many people have heard of the Santa Monica Mountains Conservancy, for example.
I was going to ask you, what would be some that I would be familiar with besides PV? So Santa Monica, where's another one?
Well, there are some big ones. The Nature Conservancy has a number of preserves around the state. There's
okay.
One that's not so well known called the Wildlands Conservancy that has over 100,000 acres in the Wind Wolves Preserve southwest of Bakersfield.
No kidding.
They also own a very extensive whitewater preserve north of Palm Springs that runs from the desert up to the San Bernardino Mountains. Those of you that may be familiar with the Tejon Ranch, as you go over Interstate 5 over the Grapevine, they have a 240,000-acre preserve that's been established in the last 5 years or so, which is still largely closed to the public, where the Wildlands Conservancy lands are generally open. But the Tejon Ranch Preserve is working on increasing public access.
All right, because I really don't understand how this works. So, you know, it can't be a stupid question if you don't understand it. Who owns the land?
Okay, that's a very good question, Marcia.
Oh, thank you. That is even on my list.
Okay, the intent of a trust or a conservancy is to preserve something for some time in the future, and land conservancies are intended to conserve land or other resources in perpetuity. Back east, there are a number of them that preserve farmland or ranch land or historic district or building. But in the west, they are primarily for open space or for water quality areas. And they either acquire land by purchasing it directly, or there's a mechanism called a conservation easement, in which you can actually separate different aspects of use and access rights to land and acquire some of them, but not others. So much of the land that our organization manages, we don't actually own title to it, but we've acquired conservation easements. And in these agreements, they're basically contractual agreements that can run for various periods of time. Most of ours run in perpetuity, but they prevent, in our case, construction on the land. They require maintenance of habitat, in some cases expansion of native habitat.
Who sets the requirements?
Well, you negotiate them with the owner. So much of the land that we manage is actually owned by cities in our area. So
okay.
We have a couple parcels in San Pedro, a number of them in Rancho Palos Verdes, two in Palos Verdes Estates. No, I'm sorry, in Rolling Hills Estates.
Okay.
And in each of them, we've worked with our lawyers and lawyers from these cities and worked out agreements that are acceptable to both sides. And because they recognize the benefits of the work that we do in managing the parcels and restoring habitat, they're generally very agreeable to working with us.
So, like, for instance, what popped into my mind is the redwoods. So when you go to the redwoods, is that a conservancy?
Well, there's Redwood National Park.
Right, like How does a national park maybe differ from a land conservancy?
Well, there are national parks and also state parks, like Prairie Creek Redwood State Park.
All right.
Those are owned by the government, either with the state of California or the federal government, and they have a budget provided by us as taxpayers to manage their affairs, provide interpretive programs, in some cases to do restoration work.
All right.
And they do a wonderful job, but the federal government and the state, even the counties and localities, don't have the resources to do all
right,
the work.
Right.
And much of the land, as it turns out, in national parks and state parks actually was originally acquired by conservancies. So, for example, in the case of the Redwoods that you mentioned, there's an organization called Save the Redwoods League, and they recruited supporters and raised money and acquired much of the land that became the core of Redwood National Park and several of the state parks up in Northern California as well.
So in a land conservancy, do you have to pay taxes, or is there?
Well, we are nonprofit organizations.
Okay, cool. I like that.
So like other nonprofit organizations, we have to raise money.
Mm-hmm.
So we have supporters.
Sure.
And we use
You're a board member, right?
I'm a board member. I'm a volunteer. Our organization differs from the majority of land conservancies in that we do have a small professional staff, people who are paid to do the work. But we also have, on average, about 15,000 hours of volunteer time donated every year. We have thousands of dollars donated to us, either by people living or in the form of bequests. And this supports our operation. So
wonderful.
We have a range of things that people can do, and we'll talk later, I think,
about are going to talk about that. We sure are going to talk about that. So did you become involved in this after you you retired from teaching?
I taught until last spring.
All right. So but I bet you've been involved with this land conservancy prior to retirement?
Yes, our conservancy was formed again in 1988. I became involved with them in 1989.
Oh, so you're like
some of their meetings.
Oh, all right. So you're from the get-go pretty much. That's really great.
Well, I think almost everywhere, as we get older, we recognize that open spaces are filling up. And our conservancy was formed by some visionaries, particularly Bill Ayler and his wife Barb, who had prior experience on the city planning commission. So they were aware of laws and restrictions affecting development of open space. And he set many of our core policies, including the fact that we don't take a confrontational approach. We work with willing sellers. We identify parcels of land that we think would be good for conservation purposes. We try and set up a relationship with the property owners and with the cities, the jurisdictions in which they lie, to be able to negotiate some sort of property transfer, acquisition, or easement.
I didn't even realize what you were, as you were speaking, I'm conjuring this up in my mind. So are you saying that some of this land was residential and...
Well, it hadn't been developed yet, but okay. Many of the parcels that we have acquired or own conservation easements over had development proposals in the works,
okay.
In the pipeline.
So, I see.
So we stepped in and provided an alternative because there were people who took a more confrontational approach to some of these developments.
I see. So how many acres were in the Palos Verdes Conservancy?
Well, the lands that we manage uh-huh. are about 1,600 acres.
Whoa,
and on the Palos Verdes Peninsula, that's very pricey real estate.
You bet.
We actually only own less than 100 acres of that.
Oh, I see.
But the easements that we hold are, for the most part, again, in perpetuity.
Uh-huh.
So we have agreements with the city that will continue these. Because we have some threatened and endangered species on the lands that we manage,
right.
We've been able to get funding from federal, state,
uh-huh.
and county funding sources, and they have included as part of the grants requirements that the habitat be preserved in perpetuity. So we have their backing now in maintaining the lands that
That's
we manage.
That's terrific. For people that live all across the country and don't understand what we're dealing with here, in the Los Angeles area with all of the rain we've had, which has been really unusual for us, such concentrated rain. I know it's not all that unusual in other parts. I think it looks like our drought may be really improving. We may be getting better at this. You're up kind of high. Has all of this rain had any impact on your actual land? Do you have to worry about slides or any of that?
Yeah, much of the land that we own is sort of hillside.
Right.
So the flatter areas are developed for the most part.
Uh-huh.
And the slopes areas are the areas that we've been able to acquire.
Okay.
And coastal bluffs and things like
uh-huh.
that. So we do have a big worry about that. We haven't had major slides, although we've had some minor
uh-huh.
mudslides and things like that. I was in one of our preserves, George F. Canyon, in Rolling Hills Estates, 2 weeks ago, right after we had that big Sunday rainfall,
mm-hmm.
and there were areas of the trail that it had some rocks and mud slide on them.
Mm-hmm.
The creek itself, which generally doesn't run, especially the last 5 years because of the drought.
That's right, yeah.
But they had a huge sluice of water going through there and carrying rocks and debris down slope and mud.
Can anybody go on to the land? Is there an entrance or something that allows you to go there?
Essentially, all but a couple of we have a few parcels that we own that are isolated,
okay.
that don't have
access.
Readily available access yet. But most of the lands that we own or manage do have public access. There is a limitation there in that, for example, the city of Rancho Palos Verdes, because of its concern for impact on habitat, it does close trails from time to time. So when we've had really heavy rainfall, they'll close the trails mm-hmm. for a couple of days to make sure that they're not a hazard for visitors
sure.
as well as for the habitat itself.
Is there parking?
Most places, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Not as much as some people might like,
right.
but generally, yes.
That's nice. Well, it sounds beautiful. I know. Did you want to hold a book up? Sure.
Yeah, we actually do have a book on hiking trails on the Palos Verdes Peninsula.
Nice.
So this has information on how
okay.
to get to, how to access these sites and some of the features that you may see there, the length of the walk, the difficulty of the walk.
And you do that.
Like that.
Do you do some of those escorted nature walks?
Well, in addition to the opportunity for people to go by themselves, we do offer at least monthly nature walks. So
nice.
The second Saturday of every month, we have a public nature walk, which usually runs 40 or 50 people, but we have had as many as 300 people show
up. Oh, my goodness.
For some of these. We have a team of walk leaders, so it's not just one person with
okay.
50 people. And we try and divide up the guests so that we have 10 or 15 people per walk leader. Our walk leaders are all trained so that they're knowledgeable about the conservancy, as well as about the locations that we visit. We do also have walks. For example, our George F. Canyon site, we have a nature center, and they do moonlight walks once a month.
Oh, that must be beautiful, depending upon what the moon's doing, huh?
Well, they're generally full moon.
Full
moon. Time for the full moon, but you can go out and listen to the owls and things like that.
Oh,
there are all
wow.
sorts of.
Is there a cost?
For the moonlight walks, yes.
All right.
But for the other walks, the monthly nature walks, there are none. At our White Point facility, the White Point Nature Education Center and White Point Preserve in San Pedro, we have monthly walks, and there's actually a city ranger that guides those. And we've set up informally walks on a number of occasions in addition to the regularly scheduled ones.
How long does a walk normally take?
We aim for something around 2 hours,
all right.
But it varies with the size and of the parcel and the distance of the particular route in some cases, too, because of weather.
Sure.
For example, we've had to curtail walks because parts of the trail became unpassable.
All right. Do you take time to let people like me say, wait, I got to take a picture of that?
Or absolutely.
Because of those people drive you crazy,
probably. No, we generally walk a ways and then talk about some feature, a plant or a geological feature or something in the view. Excuse me. And then we'll welcome questions. And we generally have people of all ages, children on up.
That sounds like so much fun. I need to do that. That needs to go on my list. I have to do that. I would enjoy that, especially the moon. I mean, like, I think it would be important to sort of compare the two. Do something during the day, then do something at night. You got a whole different set of circumstances, I think, would be wonderful.
Yeah, we have the day shift that most of us are familiar with and the night shift.
Uh-huh.
And then there's also what are called crepuscular creatures.
Oh, I don't even know
what
that is.
That's a fancy word. Crepuscular means creatures that are active at twilight and dawn. And they are, in many cases, a whole third population that you don't see much during the day and you don't see much overnight.
Bats?
Mm-hmm. Well, bats can be nocturnal, too.
Okay.
But bunnies, for example.
All right.
We have lots of bunnies. And they're pretty much crepuscular. They don't come out very much during the day. They're not real active when it's super
They come
dark.
Out in the dusk, the bunnies.
Yeah. And at dawn.
I wouldn't have known that. I would have thought they would have been a daytime. What about the things that slither? How are we doing for snakes? Because, you know, none of us are all fond of those.
Well, actually, one of the canyons in the Palos Verdes Nature Preserve is Rattlesnake Canyon.
Oh, swell.
So we do have rattlesnakes. I must confess, I haven't seen more than a half a dozen or so over the last 20 years, but I don't go looking for them either. We have garter snakes. We have gopher snakes, which I see more often.
Mm-hmm.
Those are our main snakes. Then we have lizards, mostly western fence lizards.
That's neat. So do people bring their families? I mean, this is stuff that you can do, adults can do during the week, but then there's also things that families can come and do with their children as well?
We have a variety of programs for children. We have a monthly art program, for example, which is fee-based, but we
mm-hmm.
work with another organization that has artists that work with us. And we have, in our nature centers, we have programs for children. We do at the George F. Canyon site, we actually, again, for a fee, we have a birthday program.
Nice.
So children can bring their schoolmates or
mm-hmm.
friends from the neighborhood and have an activity full afternoon or morning.
Well, that's great. Do you, because you're where you're located, and there's at least two high schools up there, right? Rolling Hills and PV High are both up there.
Yes.
Do you coordinate any of your efforts with the students there so that they can maybe get some volunteer hours or anything like that? Is there any crossover?
Well, we have actually a program in every elementary school
peninsula.
Yeah. Particularly for the third grade, coordinated with the state science standards.
Uh-huh.
So every school in the Palos Verdes Unified School District, plus every school in San Pedro, a number of schools in other nearby cities, as mm-hmm. far as Barlos Niños in downtown Los Angeles.
Oh, really?
Do programs with us where we bring a state curriculum coordinated program to the classroom. And then for a grand finale, we bring them to one of our preserves so they can see firsthand and
nice.
Touch and smell the things that they've been learning about in the classroom.
That's
so it's
really
great
nice.
For them. For older kids, we do have opportunities through scouting, for example. A lot of Boy Scouts and Girl Scouts mm-hmm. do projects on our land. And we have a program called SQ, Student Serving as Science, if I got the S's right. Uh-huh. But we invite them out to participate with us in research. And adults do that as well. People that have particular interests in the plants or animals on the preserves, they work with our stewardship staff to develop programs where they can generate data that we can use.
Nice. It's a seven-day-a-week operation, I presume.
Absolutely, yeah.
And that just sounds so great. And I'm sure that if you've been doing this how long have you been doing this?
Well, the organization is coming up on 30. I haven't been with it quite that long. But
while you were teaching, you were still volunteering, correct?
Yes.
Did you get interest from your students to go over there and get?
Well, some of them didn't have a choice.
Oh, there you go. It's an assignment, is it?
Well, I taught labs in physical geography and ecology, uh-huh. and one of the things that I would do is take them out to visit sites, and whether on the peninsula or, for example, at Santa Rosa Plateau or Kern River Preserve, I would generally try and negotiate an arrangement with the preserve managers where we'd provide mm-hmm. a couple hours of volunteer labor for them if they would give us a lecture on the unique features of their facilities mm-hmm. and some of the research that they did there. So it worked out well both ways.
Oh, I bet. It was a win-win. Well, we're listening to Because We Can. We're going to take our break. We're listening to The Wind by Cat Stevens. And we'll be right back after this short break. Thanks, everybody, for listening. Stay tuned.
I've sat upon the setting sun, but never, 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 never. I never wanted water once, but never, never, never.
Hi, I'm Del A.D. Jones, and I'm a certified relationship and divorce coach.
And I'm Debbie Carlin Boyle, a certified personal trainer, fitness instructor, and health coach.
Join us on Tuesdays, 2 p.m. Pacific, for Del and Debbie's Mind, Body, Soul, and Everything in Between, exclusively on L.A. Talk Live.
Become part of the conversation with expert guests discussing life-changing topics such as relationships, divorce, longevity, parenting challenges, dating, intimacy, and so much more.
We would love to hear your opinions and questions either on our Facebook page or by calling us directly at 323-473-3100. We are Del and Debbie's Mind, Body, Soul, and Everything in Between. Tuesdays, 2 p.m. Pacific on latalklive.com.
You can also catch us on iTunes Radio, R&B, and now live on Facebook, or watch and listen directly at latalklive.com. And now on our YouTube channel, Del and Debbie Mind, Body, Soul. Reality radio handcrafted for your listening and viewing pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
Welcome back, everybody. Joni Mitchell's in the studio, don't we wish, right? Wouldn't that be so cool? Big yellow taxi. All right. Well, we're back. And now I want to, this is an educational show for me. Sometimes the show is all about music or sports or a nonprofit. I do a variety show. I know you know that if you've been following me every week. I'm coming up on my 2-year anniversary before you know it. Thank you. It's coming up. It's not too far away, actually. But this show, because I am interested in nature, I told somebody once that, you know, I couldn't live without music. I really don't think I could live without nature either. So let's talk about what biodiversity is, because I really don't know how to define it. So I'm going to you. You're the expert, professor. Tell me what this is all about.
Sure. Well, we started out, again, as a land conservancy, basically just trying to preserve open space. But we quickly realized that there were lots of things there. And they became increasingly important to us, both for our enjoyment of the land that we manage, but also as a way to acquire funding. Many people don't know this, but the Palos Verdes Peninsula actually used to be an island. It was one of the Channel Islands, and all the lowland between it and the Santa Monica Mountains and the Santa Ana Mountains were underwater.
I didn't know that.
After the island emerged. So just like the Outer Channel Islands, or for that matter, the Hawaiian Islands or the Galapagos or other islands, they develop unique populations of plants and animals. And our peninsula still has some relics of its, you know, millennia as an island. So even though we have been connected to the mainland for at least 10,000 years, we have, for example, some plants that are only found on Palos Verdes
really?
And on Catalina. We have a number of species that are actually only found on the peninsula nearby. So, for example, we have a little butterfly, the Palos Verdes
blue. Oh, the PV butterfly.
The Palos Verdes blue butterfly,
right,
which is only found on the peninsula. It has a...
Okay, I got to interrupt. Okay, because they have wings. All right. So I know we're showing a picture of this butterfly, and it's quite beautiful. Why, if this butterfly has free will, wouldn't we find it in Culver City? I mean, I don't know.
Well, organisms in general, plants and animals, look for nutrients, energy, and water.
All right.
That, those are the essentials for life. But each different region has slightly different properties in terms of the availability of water, in terms of temperature, other conditions that affect the supply of nutrients and energy and water. And soils have different chemistries. We have in California, for example, serpentine soils, particularly in central and northern California.
What does that mean?
It's a soil that's derived from a particular mineral that is toxic to most plants.
Oh.
But we have something like 250 species of plants identified so far that can thrive on serpentine soils. They're actually botanists who specialize in serpentine obligates, creatures, plants in particular, that can only live on serpentine soils. We don't have those on the peninsula, but we do have other unique combinations. The peninsula, like most of the LA Basin, is mostly old seafloor. But we do also have on the peninsula bits of old volcanic activity.
I was just going to ask, is there that volcanic?
There is volcanic activity. Actually, we're also the only place on the mainland where there is a surface exposure of Catalina schist, which is a type of metamorphic rock that actually underlies all the Los Angeles Basin. But the only exposure is in George F. Canyon.
So people can see it?
People can't see it if they're willing to hike.
Okay, so you got to take a
well, in the creek that goes through the canyon, too, there are chunks of Catalina schist there. And if you go around the coast of the peninsula, because that rock is something like 95 million years old, it has eroded over the years, and there's actually a sandstone formation that's built up of sediment from eroded Catalina schist. So it's...
You know, I know you're saying 95
million.
That just
back when the dinosaurs roamed the
that
earth.
That just, well, yeah, La Brea tar pits, right?
Well, that's 10 to 40,000 years.
Oh my gosh.
So this is 20 times older than that.
I can't even wrap my mind around that concept. It is that's a staggering number to me. It's amazing.
Well, it turns out most people in the Los Angeles area, at least, are familiar with the La Brea tar pits.
Right.
It's really nationally and probably internationally famous for its late Pleistocene megafauna, in particular the big animals, the mammoths and mastodons and saber-toothed cats, dire wolves, giant armadillos, giant beavers, and so forth. There's actually a site on the Palos Verdes Peninsula where virtually the same crew of actors have been found. We have a bridge connecting San Pedro to Terminal Island, and when they dug the foundations of the bridge, they found essentially the same creatures, the mammoths
really?
And mastodons and all those creatures. And we used to have redwoods down here back during the Ice Ages because the whole climate was cooler and wetter year-round.
Yeah. It's amazing. All right, so...
So let me get back to biological
biodiversity.
Yes,
I'm sorry.
Biodiversity.
I'm sorry.
I told
you. No, I did. Go ahead.
But anyway, the issue biological diversity or biodiversity, to condense it, is a topic that I think a growing number of people are aware of, and it's a recognition of the fact that we are one of several million species that share the planet. We happen to be one that increasingly monopolizes the planet's resources. So we control about half the planet's water supply, about half the biological productivity of the land surfaces. But all these other creatures are here, and we're learning that they are essential, really, to our quality of life. Natural ecosystems and the creatures that occupy them clean our air. They purify our water. They benefit us in general ways like that, and many of them also have individual properties as plants or animals that are critical to us. All of us like to eat, and everything that we eat, except for those of you that are dirt eaters, which there are, we eat plants and animals and fungi, and they come from nature, and many of them are improved or enhanced by crossbreeding with wild creatures. Pharmaceuticals, another good example. About half of all the pharmaceuticals that we use originated from wild plants and animals.
Really?
So something like penicillin comes from a mold. Aspirin comes from willow bark. There are a long list of cancer treatments like Taxol that come from the Pacific yew, or Vincristine and Vinblastine that come from the Madagascar periwinkle.
The Madagascar periwinkle, that is still a thriving plant on the conservancy.
No, it's from Madagascar. People do use it in landscaping in Southern California.
Okay.
But the point I'm making is that there are plants all around the world that we have learned, and are still learning, have valuable potential benefits to us.
Uh-huh.
We rely on fibers.
Sure.
Cotton, linen, wool, silk, even spider silk that come from natural creatures and that we use that are billion-dollar industries. We use timber and other materials that come from natural organisms. One of the first industries on the Palos Verdes Peninsula was whaling. And back in those days, whales were hunted for whale blubber, which was electricity back in those days. Mm-hmm. That's how you fueled lights, street lights and things like that, and lamps inside the house. The cartilage and bone from whales were used in corsets and a wide variety of other products. So we have a long, long history of using natural resources in a variety of ways. And again, animals produce those things. Let me give you an example of how that benefits industry and our economy. The top agricultural crop in California is grapes. So we have table grapes that we may feast on year-round. We eat raisins and put them in our kids' lunches. And we drink grape juice, whether or not it's fermented. And
is that wine?
That's wine.
Okay.
Well, wine grapes, production of grapes for wine was introduced by the Mission Fathers over 200 years ago. But twice during the 1800s, the wine production in California was wiped out because of a pest.
Beetle. No, what was it?
It's an aphid-like creature called phylloxera.
Yes, I remember knowing about that.
And phylloxera decimated the production, and the reason we have grapes today and the reason why it's the number one crop in California to the tune of billions of dollars a year is that it was discovered that there are native grapes that are resistant to phylloxera.
Oh.
So virtually every commercial vineyard in California now, if you visit them, and they love visitors.
Yes, they do.
If you go out and look at the vines, they have a wild rootstock with commercial varietals grafted onto them. Tomatoes, another major crop in California, are a big crop because we found native wild creatures, relatives of tomatoes that were found in South America, that increase the sugar content and other aspects of the plant's chemistry that enhance its shelf life and its flavor. So unfortunately, commercial product development has taken away much of the flavor, but the shelf life is still a benefit that comes largely from the fact that we could hybridize tomatoes with these wild relatives. And you can go down an inventory of crops grown in California
the
world.
They're flashing through me. Walnuts, garlic, all kinds of things are going through my mind.
I have a California black walnut tree in my backyard.
There you go. That's what I'm saying. You know, it happens. Let's move away from that topic because I'm kind of on the animal side of life. Right here in Westchester, right in this dense community, we're having a coyote issue. What do you see over on Palos Verdes and your land conservancy? What kind of animals are out and about?
We do have coyotes, and mm-hmm. obviously there used to be not just mammoths and mastodons, but grizzly bears and all sorts of massive creatures. But because we've developed so much of the land, those are gone, and the parcels that we have remaining in our area mm-hmm. are smaller. The largest contiguous open space we have is about 1,000 acres. So there are no herds of deer or elk.
Buffaloes roaming through.
But we do have occasional foxes. We have a lot of birds in particular, lots of raccoons, opossums, and things like that, ground squirrels.
Skunks.
Lots of skunks.
Yeah. Do they all get along? Who's in charge? Who's in charge, Dr. Doolittle?
Well, in every ecosystem, there's a hierarchy of producers and consumers.
Sure.
So the higher order predators eat the animals lower on the food chain. And we have, again, foxes and to some extent raccoons. Coyotes are episodic. We have them for a while and then mm-hmm. they go away for a while and they reappear. So there, you can't just walk out any day and say, I'm going to go find a coyote.
Really, I think one of the most shocking things I ever saw was just these gigantic raccoons in my driveway, because I feed a feral cat. Besides feeding the wild birds, I feed a feral cat. And I'm coming home and I'm driving up the driveway and it's like, and I mean, they're huge. Raccoons are big.
They're big, but they can get through a pet door.
I know, because one tried to come into my house after we had put a cat down, and I thought, what is knocking on the pet door? And it's like, oh my God, it's a raccoon. It's like, oh, you couldn't have been here before, because if you were in my house, I'd have known it.
Yeah, I've had as many as four in my house.
Really? Through a cat door?
Yeah, a mom and three kids.
Oh, they heard. The sign was out. Eat at Allen's. You must have had some good food, right? That's funny. All right, so let's talk a little bit about your research program that you have going on. What is that? What's all about the research that you're doing currently?
Well, again, we're fortunate compared to many land trusts or land conservancies in that we do have the resources to support at least a modest professional staff.
Mm-hmm.
And essentially all of our staff members are people that have at least master's degrees in biology or ecology, and they do research for us. Mm-hmm. So our executive director, Andrea Vona, our stewardship director, Adrian Mohan, and we have a native plant nursery run by Chris Sarabia. All those folks have master's degrees.
Wonderful.
And Chris in particular, working at the native plant nursery, we grow tens of thousands of native plants a year that we transplant to our preserves.
I was just going to ask you that. I was going to ask you, do you do that? Do you plant and cultivate this area?
Yes. So we have agreements with the organizations we work with, like the Wildlife Conservation Board, the cities whose lands that we manage and have conservation easements over. For example, with the city of Rancho Palos Verdes, we are required to restore at least 5 acres of land per year. And it costs about $50,000 per acre to develop the plants and get the materials to propagate them and transplant them. And at the nursery, we have a whole separate operation again. So we have to have irrigation there.
Sure.
On the actual land sites where we plant them, we're generally restricted in applying water because of the risk of landslide and things like that on the Palos Verdes Peninsula, where many people have heard of the Portuguese Bend landslide, among others. So we have to be very careful with water there. But when we are germinating and growing them, they need water to get off to a healthy start in life. And
so do you actually have sprinkler systems and stuff?
We have drip and sprinkler
systems.
Okay. The plants are concentrated, the sprinkler systems.
They're concentrated because it's like a nursery in that you're going to grow them and then you're going to take them.
Yes, so we pack them in where we can sprinkle them from overhead sprinklers.
I see.
Or drip them. But our nursery manager, Chris Sarabia, also does experiments on how to most effectively germinate and grow plants, because we're making a major investment. We want to make sure we're getting the most bang for our bucks.
You bet.
So he experiments with different soil mixes, with soil inoculants. Many people don't realize it, but virtually all the plants out there in the big wide world are in symbiotic relationships with fungi. Fungi are really good at releasing chemicals that break down minerals in the soil.
Is that a good thing or a bad thing?
That's a good thing.
That's what I was told. I was telling you my landscape person was on last week, and she would say to me, if you see mushrooms growing in your grass or someplace, just step on them and kind of move them into the soil, because it's like a vitamin.
Yeah, the mushroom is really just the reproductive structure for filaments, the fungus, most fungi, consist primarily of networks of filaments in the soil, and they grow. In some cases, there are fungi that literally can cover 100 acres. The biomass of some fungi that have been documented is bigger than the biomass of a sequoia.
Really?
They can be huge, but we don't see them because most of them is underground.
You're not talking about the specific fungi.
Not the mushroom that we see, but the filaments underground.
I see.
So fungi mm-hmm. can't photosynthesize.
Okay.
They can't feed themselves. They can absorb nutrients. But what they do around the globe is they form partnerships with plants, often very specific, where the plant photosynthesizes. But to do that, it needs minerals, and the fungus helps it extract minerals from the soil. So it gets the minerals thanks to the fungus, and then it feeds the fungi.
I was in a whole mushroom phase. I was in New Hampshire, and there's big, gigantic sycamore trees or whatever they were, and sugar maples. And then you would see this big white plate.
Yeah, bracket fungus.
Oh, my gosh, that's so cool. Or these bright pink ones. It's like almost or like salmon-colored. I mean, there was a point where I just did a whole blog for like 2 weeks just on mushrooms and fungi.
Well, some of those are parasitic.
They're not good.
They're not all helpful, but
yes.
Many of them are, just like bacteria. I mean, there are bacteria in all of us. We have more genetic material in us from bacteria in our intestines and guts and our brains and our hearts and every place else in our bodies than we do our own DNA. But there are some bacteria out there that are not so good.
Yeah.
Most of the ones that are inside us are actually beneficial to us.
Okay. That's good to know. I noticed that I had a question here about the recreational opportunities, but I think, are there any that we haven't talked about so far?
Well, volunteering is one thing that thousands of people do.
Truly.
Nationwide, there are about 8,000 people who work full-time or part-time in land conservancies, but there are millions of people who volunteer.
That's so neat. And, you know, I know that Alan is sitting in the studios in my backyard here in Westchester, but those of you that are listening in other parts of the country, there are land conservancies there. And what a wonderful way to get involved and to get outdoors and get unplugged. Sometimes I spend so much time in front of the computer, I think my brain is just going, what's going to happen? Where's the air? It's just awful. We're listening to a song called Paradise by John Prine. And I chose this, well, you chose it. And I was saying to you, I've never heard of this guy. What a great singer. So he's back in the day, you said, with Chris Christopherson?
Well, Chris Christopherson was the person that essentially discovered him to a national audience. But he's been around since the late 60s and early 70s, and he's still performing.
Well,
he just never gained the fame of Christopherson and others.
Well, now he's got it because he's on my show, for heaven's sakes. For all of you that aren't familiar, his last name is spelled P-R-I-N-E. First name, John. Song is Paradise. Kind of like what we've been talking about all morning. So stay tuned, everybody. We'll be back after this quick break.
Mr. Peabody's coal train has hauled it away.
Hi, this is WDC.
And this is Robert Lamar.
Inviting you to join us every Saturday, 2 p.m. Pacific, for Scholar Me Live.
Join us as we bring you weekly sports highlights,
interviews with student athletes, coaches and pros,
song of the week,
contest giveaways,
Scholly B female and male students of the week.
So don't forget to tune into the number one social network,
the sporty and sexy Scholly B Live, Saturdays, 2 p.m. Pacific,
exclusively on LATalkLive.com
and the American Talk Live Broadcast Network.
Reality radio, handcrafted for your listening and viewing pleasure.
This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
Like, I want to do like a karaoke right now. I don't know why. I've never done karaoke in my life. But when the music comes on, this is called Just a Song Before We Go. Before I go, I can't even get the words right, which is why I couldn't probably do karaoke, because you have to read it and sing it and be on tune and look like you know what you're doing. Probably ain't going to happen. Before I finish with this program with you today, Alan, I got to tell you about this guy next week. I love this life I have. So this guy's name is Scott Jankowski, Polish, nice Polish guy. Met him walking his dog in front of my house. And you know me, yap, 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 here's my business card. Anyway, so it turns out that this guy, Scott, is a personal trainer, which is great. And he's an author, which is super great. But what's so interesting about him, and what we're going to talk about as well, is the fact that he has survived 2 brain cancer surgeries, and a 3rd brain cancer that was resolved without requiring surgery at UCLA Medical Center. And he has taken that opportunity of coming back from really a devastating surgery to really good health, to come back. And then he's a volunteer at UCLA and speaks to people. He's been featured on our local news. He's really giving hope to people that are scared. And I'm so looking forward to you meeting Scott next week. So you'll want to listen to that show as well. But now, this is back to you. And this is going to be all about the birds. I'm a bird girl. What can I tell you? You know, I've got my owl sweater on. I got my little bird thing here. I got my birds behind me. You know, I feed them every day. I take pictures of them. I don't have grandchildren. How many grandchildren do you have?
I have 5, ranging from 4 to 17.
4 to 17. I have birds, ranging from big to small. A Cooper's hawk, the mourning doves, the ring-tailed doves, the little brown birds and the variety that they are, because sometimes I just don't know what to call them, so I call them the little brown birds. I've got my squirrels. I name them. I've got the crows. Holy cow. My neighbors, they don't listen to my show. They don't like me. My one neighbors, because they're loud. I know they're loud. I can't help that they're loud. I've started a habit, and I don't feel that I can break it. So when I travel, and I've got the good fortune of going to Africa, my neighbor feeds my birds. How can you not feed them once they're expecting? So I've been lamenting because of the rain we've had. You know, birds can get kind of mushy, so it's like, how do I feed my birds? They're looking at me like, well, we don't care if it's raining. We still want to eat. What makes you think we don't eat because it's raining? It's like, I know. I'm trying to figure this out. Anyway, I do really love birds. So can we just spend a few moments? I know I've posted a couple of pictures of a couple of your birds that are seen, the cactus wren and the gnat catcher. What kind of birds do you have coming floating through?
Well, those are the 2 most important because they are federally and state listed as threatened species.
Okay.
So we get some funding support.
Terrific.
For maintaining habitat for them.
Yoo-hoo.
The cactus wren, as the name would suggest, is a bird that will only live in dense mature patches of cactus.
Okay.
And it typically wants at least an acre of intensive cactus habitat, and they'll actually build their nest in cactus.
Wow.
The gnatcatcher lives in coastal sage scrub habitat, which is the most common kind of habitat in coastal areas in Southern California. And they won't go into backyards or other kinds of habitat. Neither of these birds migrate seasonally. So
they stay
in cactus for the coastal cactus wren, and they stay in coastal sage scrub for the California gnatcatcher.
And are they widely seen? Like, if I was to bring my camera and take a walk with you, would I see them?
If I could take you to the right places.
Okay.
So you won't see them just wandering
around.
Haphazardly. but they are there, and mm-hmm. we have a wide range of other birds as permanent residents, as well as an interesting mix of birds that show up during seasonal migrations, and then some birds that just get lost.
Right, right. The orioles, do the orioles come through?
We have orioles.
Okay.
You mentioned earlier cedar waxwings.
Oh,
in
I had cedar waxwings in my yard. Oh my gosh, I'd never seen one, and there were so many of them.
They look like cardinals.
They look like cardinals. You're right,
because
they
had bright red.
Yeah, they were bright yellow, and it just so happened the time of day that I saw them, it was about 7:10 in the morning. I'm facing west on the west side of my yard, so that meant the sun where it was in the east was shining on these birds. And I was just out there doing my thing, what I do, because I have a fountain in my yard, so I really have the good fortune of having hummingbirds, and even the crows will go into the fountain when I have to be very still. They have really good hearing. Man, if I just start running the water in my kitchen, they know, they can hear it. But those waxwings, there must have been 30 of them, and they were there, and then they were gone. And I've just never seen them again.
Well, another bird like that that's a great one for spelling bees is the Phainopepla.
What is
that? Are you
that?
Familiar with that?
No.
It looks sort of like a cedar waxwing or a cardinal, but they're gray to black in color. Like the cedar waxwings, they generally hang out in groups of a dozen or more. And they're probably a bit more common further inland, but we do get them along
they're
the coast
social,
as well.
They're social, as opposed to Phoebe. I just call her Phoebe.
Yeah,
that bird, that's a solo bird.
Yeah, you'll see black Phoebes and Say's Phoebes in our area and throughout much of Southern California, and they are solitary birds. They'll find a perch, and they'll just sit there, and you'll see them fly out 10 yards and do a little maneuver when they're catching a bug out of the air, and then they'll go back and perch and
you can, and
they're
repeat. Distinctive. We've come to the end of the show. Is that possible? I need like 15 more minutes. If you are interested in learning more about the Palos Verdes Peninsula Land Conservancy, it's really easy to find on the internet. You can learn about how to donate. I don't think you'd turn any donations down.
No, volunteer.
Volunteer, do that. If you're interested in being outside, find one in your neighborhood. And I just want to thank you. We didn't meet till you showed up today, and I've enjoyed this. I know that I'm going to come out. I'm going to look for you. We're going to take a walk, and I'm just delighted that you were able to join us today. So thank you so much.
I'll look forward to inviting you down to visit one of our preserves.
I would love that. Okay, everybody, we've come to the end of another show. How does that happen? So go out there, have a great day. Come back and meet my buddy Scott and learn about brain surgery and how you can recover effectively and successfully. What an inspiration he is. Have a great week. Go out and do something well. Remember that smile of yours. It can say everything in any language. And I'll see you again next week. Thanks so much for your constant support on the Born to Talk radio show. See you next time.
Thank you for tuning into LA Talk Live and the Talk Live Broadcast Network, original reality radio, handcrafted for your listening and viewing pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk. Stay tuned.